Good evening, everyone. My name is Benjamin Nishie. I'm 25 years old, and I was invited to speak in front of you guys tonight, and I said yes out of reflex. And you know what? It's a decision that I do not regret, because if I could just put a little bit of, you know, my story into you and to tell you just, you know, this much of what Hope Builders has done for me, and I could give back just this much, you know, then I'll be a happy man at the end of the night. So I already give you my name, my age. So now where I grew up, you know, I was born in Harbor City in Los Angeles County. And throughout my childhood, I moved quite a bit. You know, I don't come from a broken home or a dysfunctional family. My family is really good. You know, my parents are still together to this day. And my older sister, she actually just recently completed her master's program. And my younger sister is at Vanguard University. Now, I'm just going to fast forward a little bit. I just wanted to tell you a little about me so you understand that everything that I did in my life was a direct result of my actions and my thoughts and has nothing to do with the way I was raised. You know, I was raised really well. Now, I dropped out of school at a very young age. You know, I had this problem when I was young that I learned really fast. And the problem with learning really fast is that you think that you're smarter than everybody else. And true story. So I thought it was a good idea to drop out of high school. Dropped out of school in the ninth grade. And I did that because, you know, what are these teachers going to give me? What really can they put into my life that I'm going to actually use in the real world? And in my mind, nothing. So I went home and, you know, my mom, she's a teacher, and my dad, he's a bus mechanic. And I brought them that news. And, you know, needless to say, they didn't take it over very well. But they're the type of people who will give you the opportunity to make your own mistakes and to lead your own life. So they essentially left me with this ultimatum, which is, you know, go back to school or do your thing. And of course, being the world wise man that I was at 15 years old, I took the latter. You know, and that was the beginning of, you know, a pretty difficult life. So I moved out, and you know, I would work here and there, and you know, I struggled and I survived and I struggled and I survived. And then at 19, there was a very pivotal moment in my life, and I got a DUI. And again, you know, because I know everything, I think that I could fight it, I could beat it. You know, I don't know if everyone here knows this, but California has a zero tolerance policy for underage drinkers and drivers, and I didn't know that. So I took him to court, and well, I lost. And you know what? With most people, what comes with a DUI is a ticket, suspended license, things of that nature. And what happened for me was, you know, I essentially lost my life. You know, I lost my truck, which in turn led me to losing my job, which in turn led me to losing my housing, which finally left me with no girlfriend. And at 19 years old, that's pretty much like your world is over. And so I went back to the neighborhood where I used to hang out, you know, see my buddies, and I, you know, I pull up and I, you know, I'm drinking a beer and smoking a little bit of pot, and you know, the next thing I know, there's a meth pipe and I'm smoking. And that was another crucial point in my life, because that was the beginning of the true downhill. So I struggled with drug abuse for years, and you know, criminal activity goes hand in hand with drug abuse, and that was my life. You know, in and out of jails. You know, I'm a two-time convicted felon, two prison terms, and I'm saying this not because I'm proud of it, and in fact, it's probably the thing that I'm least proud of, because you know, I should have been better than that, but you know, that's a story for another day. So I paroled from my first prison term, and I decided to go straight back into the swing of things, you know, work a little bit, you know, and try and keep that job for as long as I could, and go out and do crime at night and avoid the police at every possible opportunity I could. And then I got arrested 2 months after I paroled. and I'm sitting in the back of the police car, and I know I'm going back to prison. It's not just going to be a county term. It's not just going to be, you know, 30 days and I'm out and I'm back running and gunning again. I knew I was going back for a little while. So in the back of the police car, I'm just thinking, what the heck is my problem? You know, fast forward 30 minutes, and I'm in the central men's processing right here in Santa Ana. And I'm sitting on that concrete slab, and I'm thinking to myself, man, I got to do something with my life. But I didn't know where to start. So fast forward a little bit, you know, I do my time and I parole, and, you know, it was suggested to me, you know, very strongly by my parole officer that I go to a rehab. And that could have well been the biggest step forward in my life up until that point. Because at that rehab, I was introduced to a counselor, and he suggested that I take a look at this little program called Taller San Jose Hope Builders. He said, look, man, if you're willing to change your life, then this is the place for you. You know, but if you're not willing to take a major step forward and you're not willing to put everything that you have into it, don't waste your time and don't waste theirs. And so I trusted this man, so I took his advice and I went down there. But I didn't go down there with a smile like, oh yeah, you know, I got this, this is mine. I went down there thinking, you know what, this is just gonna be like every other real job. You know, I'm gonna go in for the application, and they might take the application, but they won't give me an interview because I'm gonna have to say that I'm a felon or that I've, you know, had a lot of drug problems in my life. And when I walked in there to get that, to fill out the application, it was quite the polar opposite. I was welcomed in with smiles and open arms, and they told me to come back. And I left that office that day, you know, quite literally with my mind blown. You know, I'm just like, okay, well, you know what? I'm just gonna go to this interview, and I'm gonna give them an opportunity to know me. You know, I'm gonna lay it all out on the table, and I'm just gonna, you know, hey, whatever, you know, with the expectation that they're gonna say, you know what, man, you know, I appreciate your time, and you know what, maybe you should just go to a temp agency. You might be able to get some work there. So again, fast forward a little bit, and I go in for my application or for my interview. And the woman who interviewed me at the end of the interview, she said, she thanks me for my transparency, saying, thank you for putting it out all on the table for me. And I think you'd be a perfect candidate for our program. So I didn't think I could get my mind blown twice with the same organization, but it happened. So I start with this program. I was in the construction training program. We actually just had our last day yesterday through the program. And what a valuable experience this has been in my life. Who would have thought 20 weeks could do so much for a person? You know, I went in thinking that I was unemployable, that, you know, my life was very limited as far as where I could go and what I could do because of my past. And in, you know, it's a 20-week program. The first 10 weeks for us is in class studies. You know, they teach us math, or at least go over it. You know, try and get your skills brushed up to where, so you'll be employable. So when you go to the field, you'll be ready to work. And then they also teach you basic trade stuff, you know. It's impossible to fit everything from all the trades into 10 weeks, but they touch enough of the iceberg that when they send you into the field, you'll at least be ready to start. And that's what happened with me. You know, the last 10 weeks of the program, they send you out to a construction company or a contractor, and they give you that real world experience. You know, that that stuff that they teach you is applicable knowledge. It's not just something that's for here and there. So for the last 10 weeks of my life, I've been working at a job site in San Bernardino through a company called Mammoth Electric, and it has been such a growing experience for me, because now I know that I'm worth something. You know what I mean? A couple years ago, you would have looked at me and said, man, that guy is just a hopeless dope fiend. Today, a dopeless hope fiend. I'm right there. So basically, that's where I'm at right now. Now, right here and right now is all fine and dandy, but what's next? You know, today I have goals. I'm not just a man who stands here like, okay, I'm gonna do this and I'm just gonna do the day by day and, you know, hope everything goes good. That's not enough for me. I heard once upon a time that a vision without action is nothing but a dream. and I'm really not into dreaming. I want to work today for what is going to be my future tomorrow. My future tomorrow looks like this in my head. You know, it's a stable life, not just financial stability, but mental stability, emotional stability, everything that goes along with well-being, overall well-being. You know, I'm looking to start my career. You know, I'm not just at a job where there's a short ceiling, where there's a low ceiling. I'm at a place where I can grow, where I could become the man that I envision. You know, I'd eventually like to be a homeowner. You know, I can only assume that was such a great feeling for each and every one of you when you went in and you got those keys and you said, you know what, this is mine. I would like to experience that at one point in my life. You know, I'd like to be that guy that, you know, we all sit in traffic, Southern California, you gotta love it. And I'd like to be that guy, you know, sitting in traffic, you're sitting in traffic, you look over to your right and you see me just sitting there smiling, bobbing to my music or whatever, and you think to yourself, man, that guy probably pays his taxes. You know, I want to be that person. You know, and I also, I don't know if I heard this somewhere, but I read this week, or I read this recently, or what it was, but it kind of struck me a little bit hard right here in the heart, and it was something like this. You know, on our headstone or on our tombstone, there's a birth year, a dash, and the death year. That little dash represents our life. And what that dash is and what it represents is something that I want to fulfill. I want to leave a legacy. I don't want to just be here to kill my time while I'm here on earth. You know, I want to do something with it. I want to help another individual like I've been helped, because that would just give me all the joy in the world.